Okay, I'm excited to present the first talk of today, which is by Jean-Baptiste, Eugen, and Massimo, will tell us about how Kdenlive became the great and awesome video editor it is today.
Okay, thanks for your welcome. I am Jean-Baptiste Mardel. I have been the Kdenlive maintainer for the past 18 years, and I'm happy to be here with you at Akademy. Some of you might already know me, as I have been on stage a few times already, but it's the first time I'm not alone on stage, so I have some team members with me, so it makes me really happy because Kdenlive is really a community and a team project, so it's great to not be alone on stage. I'm going to quickly introduce you with the team. So we have been mostly having online meetings in the last years. We hope to be able to make a sprint soon. In the team who couldn't make it today, there is Farid, Julius, Remy, and Camille. So I just want to say hi to them today. So this is the whole team with Massimo and Eugen who are today. So I will now let the other members of the team introduce themselves, and
Good morning, everyone. My name is Eugene Moore. I'm joining the Kdenlive core team in 2018. I'm mainly behind the scene. The coder is Jean-Baptiste Mardel. I'm more about documentation and bug tracking and the homepage and all what is behind the scene needed that we can keep Kdenlive alive.
Hello everybody, I'm Massimo, I'm a video editor, a filmmaker, and a consultant of the project. It's 10 years that I'm on the project, and I don't know what to say. I'm very happy to be here because I'm very fond of this project and of the guy that worked with us to create what we are doing. And as we are a video editor application, to me, the best way to introduce ourselves is by showing you a video.
Kdenlive is a community project which aims to deliver a free and open video editing software application to allow everybody to produce quality content in order to increase the democratization of the media. The application is a graphic interface written in C++ with Qt and KDE libraries for the MLT framework written by Dandenity, which relies on FFmpeg to decode and encode almost all the video and audio formats that are out today, and which hosts effects libraries like Freyr and MoveIt for video, and LadSpot and Socks for audio. By following the official documents that we can find on the internet, the project was launched by Jason Wood, who released version 0.2.3 in October 2003. Soon, Kdenlive 0.2.4 followed, but the community did not yet exist and the group was very small. The project stopped for 2 years. Before the end of 2005, Jean-Baptiste Mardel, who heard that the project would be reactivated, offered his help, and in 2006, he signed the post of the new release 0.3 of the program. From this moment on, he became the main reference point for the project. Version 0.4 and 0.5 are soon distributed, but there is an issue. A refactoring of the code is needed to go forward. The program has to be moved from KDE 3, which is not compatible with MLT, to KDE 4. The rewriting ends in 2008, followed by several new releases, but in 2011, a further migration from KDE 4 to KDE 5 was needed to allow the program to grow. In 2012, a crowdfunding campaign is launched to fund the operation, and before the end of 2014, the goal is reached. Then finally, in 2015, Kdenlive becomes an official KDE application. Jean-Baptiste was invited to Akademy to present 10 years of activity. The new perspective is to make the project even bigger. Before the end of the year, the first Kdenlive Cafe is announced with the aim of getting more people involved. During this virtual meeting, it immediately became clear that in order to grow, Kdenlive needed to be cross-platform. The Windows version was announced, and 2016 began with a sprint meeting, followed by the new logo and the new site. but as soon as the development of new features started, it was evident that the code for the timeline had to be rewritten because it was too old and no longer fit. Everybody knew that the refactoring could take several months or years, but the community did not lose enthusiasm. In 2018, a new roadmap was written, and in 2019, the refactored code was distributed, although some fine-tuning was still needed. Then finally, since 2020 and continuing up to now, the long-awaited new features, along with a plethora of new effects and dozens of important improvements, have been continuously added to create the most powerful, free, and open video editing application ever.
We have about 100,000 users using Kdenlive daily or weekly or frequently. If you have so a lot of users, you get a lot of feedback as well. So if the software is running well, you get no feedback. If we have a release like 2304, the bell is ringing after 30 seconds. You have issues, a lot of bugs, not usable. So have a lot of user feedback very soon if the software is not really running well. So how to communicate with this, all these users? We try to keep the communication channel as lean or as simple as possible. So we have the communication channel for notification of the software is our homepage. It's Twitter and Mastodon. The communication itself with our user, we have these channels. It's Matrix, it's our forum discuss. It's the feedback when something happens or for wishes is Bugzilla. And we have quite a big community on Reddit and give us feedbacks. And it's sometimes really a challenge to feed and check all these channels to have some adequate feedback to the supplier as well. So this one keeps about up to three people really busy behind the scene just to communicate with the users. Downloads, you see here a curve over time. These are the downloads of Windows and Mac and app images. We have a huge peak on the beginning of COVID. It looks like users like to have some video editing possibilities. And as you can see, we can keep the amount of downloads or users over time as well. What you do not see on this curve is there's a similar curve for the unique visits on our homepage, and we just found out the people going on the homepage looking for the download link, clicking on that, and download the application. That leads to us that we refurbish the homepage to make the user easier to find the download page. What is missing on these curves is flatpak downloads and the PPA downloads. And we do not really know, as the distribution is via mirror server, we do not know the download numbers from the mirror servers. Who is using Kdenlive? We just make an actual poll last week and found out about 40% is social media, it's YouTube, it's PeerTube, TikTok. I know schools using our software as well. So I get asked years ago that we can prepare a download version which is possible without additional software. So I download the packed Windows version and repack it in a self-extraction file so that the schools do not need additional software installed and do not need administration rights to install the application. This gives about 10% of our users. And interestingly, we have about 7% professional users. I think it's wedding editing, most probably. Some TV, we know. Some movies, we know as well. And then the, or the majority, only for, up to 45% is personal use, doing their vacation holidays at editing like this one. What are the platforms used with Kdenlive? Mostly half-half Windows, Linux, and a growing community on macOS. We have about 5,000 macOS downloads. On the macOS, it works only on the Linux CPU at the moment. Then, with such a community, you give a lot of feedback, and you get interesting feedbacks as well from the user when you're listening to it. Remember the YouTube part we have. So the community asks about subtitles. The community asks about markers, that you can mark the video to get the chapters in YouTube. So we investigate and found out there is a framework, FOSC, which can generate text from speech and can generate automatically subtitles. And even you have the possibility then going in the text field, click on a text, and the playhead jumps on the exactly same position. Yeah, subtitle generation. And even we improved that one, finding another thing lately is whisper. It's really crazy, yeah? This founds the notation of a sentence, the punctuation, and it's really more accurate than FOSC, I would say. Translation, and even you can make a translation to English, and it's about 90-95% accurate in the meantime. So people coming and asking how to donate to Kdenlive. There was a lot of asks from the community. They do not like to donate in a big pot, KDE. They like to spend their money directly to Kdenlive. So we go to the KDE headers, I don't know. And KDE starts a pilot project with Kdenlive that we can that users can donate directly to Kdenlive. We started this donation on the 20th of September 2022 and reached our goal within a month, meaning we collect 15,000 euros within a month. It's absolutely crazy. It just went up. I made a forecast by myself, and my forecast say, yeah, within a month we should reach the goal. In the meantime, it's about 27,000, I heard yesterday, because it runs in the background further on without some additional needs, let's say. This gives us the possibility to implement really bigger features like the nested timeline, which Jean-Baptiste will talk about. We can now work on stability, and we will work on performance as well to make the software even more performant. Yeah, documentation. First we thought documentation, secondary thing. It's not so important. It steals just our time, because it's a huge amount to spend just within documentation. And we checked the statistics and found out we have 3,500 views per week on the documentation itself. And then we can further down analyze the statistics. We found out a third, it's only checking out the effect part, and another third checks out only out getting started. The interesting thing is the people stay up to one and a half minute on the page itself, which is for internet, let's say, really, really long. Huh? We calculated that roughly 10 up to 15% of our users use our new documentation manual. And at the moment, we are ongoing with updating the whole effects part, that the user has a better overview of effects, what they are doing, how to implement these effects. And with this new possibility here in Sphinx, it's really nice. You can put in some keywords and have really a list where these keywords are found in the documentation. It's much more easier than with the old system. Yeah, copyright, this is a bit a weak part of Kdenlive, let's say, because the more users you have 100,000, maybe even more, they start stealing Kdenlive, meaning Google advertisements, links to other software, we have such cases, or just take the name and behind is just a money collector, something like this one. So we start protecting Kdenlive as good as possible. The logo and the name is copyright under KDE at the moment. And we going on and have in the source code each file with a copyright, an SPDX copyright, and make really sure we protect our work, our 20-year-long work now with proper copyright, which is really tricky. The goal is to keep Kdenlive free without cost for the future. Thank you.
Sorry for the mic. Now what makes Kdenlive so successful? One thing that I think is very important for Kdenlive success is that we have a vision for the project. This is where Massimo, he will talk a bit later about it, has a very important role because we have a focused vision of what we want to achieve, what we want users to be able to do for Kdenlive. So I think it's an important part to have a vision for the project. We also try to listen to our users. So the two things are linked. I think it's important to have an idea of where we want to go, but also to listen to user input and to do the best of the two things. And also, at one point, we also realized that doing too much things was not good. At one point, we had a video capture, we had a DVD wizard, we had a stop motion widget. So we had lots of features, but everything was working not so good. So we tried at some point a few years ago, we really decided to refocus, to have less features, but to try to make them work better. I think that's one important thing also in the project evolution. Now the things that we don't do so well, it was really quite, the last release, 2304, was a good demonstration of what we don't do so well. So we'll try to improve. Automated testing, we have some automated testing since a few years, but we need to improve, to increase the testing. We also, since a few years, we talk about organizing test days before the release, because we have a large user community, to organize test days, to gather feedback before the release. It's something that we never really managed to do. And another issue that we have is that Kdenlive is a big project with many, many dependencies. So we depend on MLT as a video engine, which itself depends on FFmpeg, OpenCV, Fryer, and tens of other projects. So if one thing changes in our dependency, it can affect the whole application. So if, for example, a default parameter for an effect changes, then when we open Kdenlive, this can lead to a change. This is something that we cannot detect in our testing. So we have plans to improve.
One thing that we want to do is continue improving our current test base. Another thing to prevent this issue with dependencies affecting our application is to have a rendering test suite. That's something that we started to work on. It means that we have an automated script that open a project, renders a video file, and compare it to a reference rendering. And this way, we can detect any if anything changes in our dependencies that affects the rendering. This will be detected by this test suite. So this is a project that we want to definitely implement before the end of the year that will also bring a better regression testing. Because yeah, that's also one thing with the increase of in popularity. We have lots of users and also the expectations are a bit higher, so we just can't keep breaking everything on each release. So we're really trying to go in a more professional way and have better testing, regression testing. Another thing that we want to explore is something that will be talked at Akademy is a GUI testing with Selenium. This is something that we don't do at all, but I think it's also an interesting approach because this is something that we absolutely don't test, and yeah, some parts of the UI would really need to be tested too. So now, what changed over the years? So I already talked about the popularity of the software. Another thing is that before, 10 years ago, we only had Linux versions, so packaging was very easy. We just prepared an archive of the file and we let distributions do the work. Now, we provide packages for many platforms. We have Windows, Mac, AppImage, Flatpak, PPE, Snaps, and yeah, a few more. So it's a huge job to do this packaging. This is something that really changed over the years. I think it has some, of course, some really nice advantages. It brings our code faster to the users, so we can also react faster to the feedback. But the problem is that it's a lot of work. So we have some, we use the KDE tools to build these packages. We use Craft and we have support from KDE people on KDE infrastructure. But still for a small team like we are, it is a huge work that we can't do as well as we would like. So this is still an issue. Another thing that changed over the year is us, the team. We decided also a few years ago that we wanted to go outside of our bubble, of our Linux users' bubbles, to grow, to have Windows versions, macOS versions. I think it's important for software if we want to grow. But the problem is that we are a small team. Life also makes that, for example, I have a job, now I have a kid, so I have a bit less time. So we had to somehow find ways to make sure that Kdenlive can keep growing. So we launched a fundraiser. The idea behind the fundraiser was also that I had the opportunity to reduce my time at my day job. Currently, I have one day per week that I can spend on Kdenlive, so it's not so much to maintain such a huge project. And I had the opportunity to lower, and the goal is to have 2 days per week for Kdenlive. So we launched this fundraiser, fantastic fundraiser. It was very successful, as Eugene said. We collected money, and it was also mentioned yesterday, we have not yet spent any money. So why is this? As I said, I had the opportunity to lower my day job, but it takes some time. So I hoped I could just switch like this, but it takes some more time. So the idea is really that this money will be used when I have some extra time. We also want to hire a few people, maybe for some dedicated tasks, but that's something also that we are not very sure how to manage the hiring. All these things take some time, and since managing Kdenlive is also already a big, huge thing, so things take more time than we planned or than we would like. And now it's demo time. So because we talk a lot, but I think it's also nice to also demonstrate a few of the things that we can achieve with Kdenlive. So Massimo, you can come, is going to demonstrate a few features that were recently implemented. So like a nested timeline that caused a lot of regressions, but we are working on it to fix it, and it has some nice advantages, and also speech to text.
Thank you for switching. No, I can use this one because not become too realistic. Too. Okay, so we load here our video that we just watched before. So we can scroll it. And we can have the first timeline already load here in this space. So for example, we can decide that we want to edit in our space, for example, this animation. So we start for the first frame. We play it, maybe faster, so we go back and we select the in-out point. Who knows already how it works, the program knows what I'm doing, so I set where I want to start and where I want to end my clip. I can drag it on the timeline, or I can insert straight away with our automatic system. So I can select another point, for example, could be the conclusion, for example, of our video. Starting from, for example, from here, and go to the end. Oh, I just do it. I set in point here, and for example, we stop here. So now we have a first timeline with our two clip. Now I create, for example, another timeline in our sequence folder. This is the create a new sequence. So we can select with the title of the sequence, the number of video tracks, the number of audio tracks, following our needs. We create a new timeline. As we can see, we have two tabs here. We can switch from one to the other. We load again. See, we have one and two. We load again our clip. And for example, we can decide that now we need the beginning of the video. And so we set the in point on the beginning of our animation here, for example, up to the, the title. And then we can, for example, select, when we speak about Akademy. Okay, we are Akademy, so we don't speak about Akademy. So we select the part. First I have to insert the part I selected. Then I go here. I select all the situation about Akdenlive. Done. Now what we have? We have two different timelines, but not just two different timelines, also two different clips. Because if I can load the clip inside our monitor, as you can see, we can scroll and actually trim again in and out point on our new clip. And now with the second clip that is, as I show you, contain exactly the part we decide to have. What can do now? We can, for example, add the sequence one inside the sequence two, for example. So we now have the other part, or maybe we can even create another third sequence. Where we can, of course, we decide the title, where we can put, for example, our sequence all together, have another sequence. I don't know why I didn't take the audio two or the sequence one. We do it. Okay. And now we have both the clip. Of course, we can trim it, we can slip. For example, I can click and trim that one, I can reverse it. They work exactly like with this keyboard is okay. Is can do. I don't know what I did here. Oh. Okay, I lost myself. Anyway, I can trim and refine the trimming of the clip and so on. So what is needed this system? This system, for example, if you have several footage for a project, for example, that it's the same footage that you can share for different, you make to a series of episodes based on the same footage, you can load in the same project all the footage you need, and then you edit different version of episode one, episode two, episode three, and then you can export each timeline differently, separately in another video. So, and you can also recycle, edit part from a video in another video. For example, you've created a timeline with a main title of something, you can reuse the main title in other series without redoing all the time. So by just using the same piece of timeline in the other timeline. Another stuff I want to show you is the subtitle we speak about before. So we create another timeline at this point, just to have a free space. And we take a piece of our video, for example, when we speak about, I have no audio here now. Oh, okay. I go blind, so I don't know what we are selecting, because we're speaking about subtitle, we should listen a little bit of audio, but it's okay. So, just to make a very short test, we have this clip here. So, in out point. Oh, ooh, what I'm doing. Okay. So, we open the subtitle track that is here. We click on our magic wand. And then we can timeline zone. If you can see, there is the VOSC model or the model we can select here. Now we have VOSC activated. So the selected clip, the timeline zone, and we can proceed on the subtitle generation. So in this moment, okay, we have just this table because it's what I selected. If we have very short, if we have more more time, more clip, bigger clip, we have all the synchronized part of the subtitle that can be moved, can be resized, can be copied, and can be also edited in this part. Also, the text could be changes in this area with the custom text, change the font, change the position, change the color. It depends what you want to do. This automatic subtitle is the same system, can work by using the clip here. We have the text editor, as we can say before, and then by using the, for example, we have an interview, we can extract the text and edit the interview by just using the text, and so we can export the edited final interview based on the all the section of the text we highlighted, and by dumping the rest of the text we don't need. What we, Jean-Baptiste speak about the vision of the future, or the vision of the project. The vision of the project comes from the idea that, from one side, we listen to the users, because the users, the community that use it, maybe have some ideas that maybe very, in the idea that we never had, in very intelligent, so we collect all the input that come from the community that make the software stronger. We know, I'm sure, that even probably software is a spine to us, because I saw in some software some features that doesn't exist before that we introduced first, so they are watching at us. And from the other side, we have also the experience of people like me that are working in the field, so they are in contact all the time with the software of big corporation software. So what the editor needs on the field in the company that uses software. So we try to make like take best practice what we found around to introduce in our software to make it the best possible, the best. So we this idea to have to implement the best practice that video editing needs is our vision. So, and for the future, we have to finish between the end of the year what we. The donators aim to have, so they ask to us, so we are in the road to reach the before the end of the year the goal where they declare we will do, and for the next year we think that we go forward with insert some AI tools, and mostly the collaborating space online to, I finished, the collaborative space to make a collaborative job between editors around the world, so make it. So if you want to proceed with question, be here for questions.
Oh, he's here.
Where do you see Kdenlive and especially video editing in Linux in the future, when most, if all, major companies that make cameras have proprietary formats that are not just not supported on Linux, there's just, it doesn't work, it won't work, and there's absolutely no documentation to start building the infrastructure so you can use formats such as like Red Cinema's digital cameras that take raw footage. Sony has another format. Apple is famous for their ProRes. There is no support for that, and those companies are doing nothing to open source their standards so we can have support. So, like, where do you see that professionally coming? How can we fix that?
I go, you go.
You can start.
There is a problem about that because this company tried to close more possible, but they have also arrangement with other companies that provide software. So if you buy sometimes some tools, you have to finish to work on some specific platform. This is actually is not something that professionals like too much. Some like, because I have an old mentality, like, you know, they don't think about opening most closed. So I buy something that works, like I buy a frigider, a freezer, so yes, to work this way. But a lot of people doesn't, mostly the younger, don't think this way anymore. So they would like to be open to use what they prefer, because it means, well, that means that I change the camera, I have to migrate to another software. No, I want to use my software. And it's always, actually, a form of scam, because actually, at the end of the day, the codec are always the same. Mostly are the contained specification with containers that close proprietary stuff. But what is inside the container? Because video files are made by containers, so the capsule that contain the stream, and the stream that is encoded by MPEG or whatever it is, or iframe, etc. So mostly they use the same way to compress the stream, so that the codec, existing codec, but maybe they try to have a different capsule, different container to close. But I see that at the end of the day, for example, FFmpeg is able at the end of the day to work around the problem. There is some patent problem of patents, of course, of copyright around this stuff. But overall, so far, I was able to manage to use almost every stream I found. In the worst of the option, you have to convert, but this happened also in Avid before, you know, the software, that sometimes you have to make conversion to match the specific software. So nothing is changed for real. So it's a challenge, of course, but, and we have to be open to new formats that change all the time, also because new compression, new way to broadcast, etc. Yeah, ask demand to be, but so far, we are doing pretty well, because I'm able to use it on the field with different devices, so it's working so far.
Maybe one thing also that we should improve and do more is that we have already a small presence in schools, but we really should do more. Also, we had a stand at All-American Film Festival, I think this year, at the beginning of this year. So making also students aware of these issues, I think it's something that will help in this field. Yeah.
Thanks. I would also like to point out to the person who asked before, there's also the Akademy Software Foundation, which depends on the Linux Foundation, that tries to open source, it tries to get industry companies to open source as much as possible, and they are quite successful. They've got many formats that are open for video effects and video effects tool chains and for timelines, etc. And I think that you are actually implementing the some of these technologies already. Is that correct?
We, for example, incorporate open time. It's true that there is an attention of the open software, mostly also in Hollywood, for example. So the fact that the company want to customize their needs, so they look for, and for Pixar or Disney, so they, BBC, so they deliver what they do. So because they develop in the open source way, they deliver, so they create standards this way that have a return from them, because if everybody adopt their standards, they don't control the standard, but anyway, they create an integration. That so I hope personally that the direction will be that in the time. And also company like Sony that have old mentality, I quote Sony because it's very old mentality in my opinion, that try to close more possible, they will not stand the impact of this mentality that is anyway, is becoming almost more spread around the in the industry, in my opinion.
There's a question from online. Will you use any collected funds to support some of the upstream projects and infrastructure that you depend on? Might you be able to get support from video and computer equipment manufacturers?
So yes, that's something that we we planned. We had contacts with MLT maintainers, so the video framework that we use, to propose them to use some of the funds. Unfortunately, they were not able, they didn't have the time or wish, mostly the time or the need for this. So, but yes, that's something we, because some of the core issues in Kdenlive are related to our dependencies. So one of the tasks in the first fundraising was a task that is has to be implemented in MLT, the video framework. So yes, that's something that we will do.
I think you said that you're working, 18 years on Kdenlive now. Is it still fun? Can you keep going?
Yes, it's still fun. So that keeps me going because also the world of video editing really changed in during this 18 years. So there is always a new thing to try to test. So it's I really enjoy it.
Yeah, maybe I can add something. Most important for him is that he has a team behind who helps him. I think years ago we had almost a burnout doing everything by themselves, and now he has a team behind who helps him, keep him away the daily task like homepage update, stuff like this one, so he can really focus on coding. We feed him what's needed or what's a bug could be as good as possible, that he just can really hack on the code.
And always new challenges to face. A bunch of inputs too.
I think this is really important, that you have a group behind and not a solo guy, because this doesn't work over such a long time.
And just we are speaking about team, of course we are open, so everybody wants to help us, it's welcome in every aspect, with packaging, coding, and supporting, testing, using, whatever. So.
Yeah, this is an interesting point. Without advertising, we have about two or three people coming from outside and ask, can I help on this and that? And we open them and say, yes, you can help. Because a good example is the documentation. We have a guy now who is heavily reading, writing documentation. We have other guys like Davey on the background on the Windows side, who checks the forum part. So it's really interesting that you get on certain stage some help from outside. People ask you, how can I help? And this is something, I think, keeping Jean-Baptiste alive.
Yes, thanks.
No more question, I guess.
Okay, thank you very much for the great talk and for Kdenlive.